Part of it. God, I feel like some of us tonight just have a weight on our hearts. Something's bothering us, God. God, we surrender to you. God, whatever that is, we give that to you. God, tonight I pray over these students. I pray over us, God. Everything you are, you give us a path, you write our story. Whenever we try to take control, it goes the wrong way. God, we want you. We want you in our lives. We want you to guide our way. Because if we don't, we'll only fall into ourselves. And that's not who we want to be. We want to be of you. We want to reflect you. We want to be the light to others.
Give it up for God, and you guys can go find your seats. Give it up for our worship team. Aren't they awesome? Come on. They amazing. So blessed. How are we doing tonight, everybody? Come on. I got three people that are woo good, and the rest of y'all are still settling in. How many of you know what these two things are? No, they're chopsticks. Chopsticks for a very giant human. Man, tonight we start a new series. It's 2 weeks. It's super short because it's Thanksgiving this month. And the last couple weeks of the month, we don't have OS. I know. It's so sad. But it's going to be good 2 weeks. So tonight, we're going to talk about the first part of this series. Help me read. What does it say? I can't hear you. Crutches. You're right. Now, who here, by a show of hands, has used crutches before? Like you've needed them. Okay, now, who has had to use crutches the longest? Like, I just did that. Thank you. Okay, no, for real, like, who has had to use crutches the longest? Anybody more than 6 months, have you had to use crutches? Wave at me. Nobody more than 6 months. 3 months? Okay, I see that hand. Okay, 4 months? See that hand? Okay, up back there. 5 months. Tisha? Okay. Tisha, would you come on up here? Give it up for Tisha. Now, I've been wondering for a while, since you're the most experienced crutch user out of all of us here, physical crutches, that is, what is the best technique for pole vaulting? No? I'm not supposed to just go...
If you want to break your
technique. Bet. Okay. Well, Tisha said pole vaulting with crutches is not what they were intended for. Okay, so give it up for Tisha. Thank you, Tisha. I really was wondering. I was like, man, like, how do I perfect my form of pole vaulting? Crutches are everywhere, though, right? Like, crutches, you see people with crutches, like these kind of crutches, but really, crutches are everywhere in society. You might not believe me, but diapers are a form of crutches. Did you know that? Diapers are a form of crutches. Crutches are a temporary means of getting back to a healthy normalcy. Like, crutches are not meant to be a permanent solution to a problem. That's why none of you, even though you've probably broken bones and had to use crutches, you haven't He kept using crutches because they're not very convenient. They hurt your armpits a little bit, and that's why they have these cool pads on the top. But diapers are the same way. Hopefully, none of you are still in diapers, right? I mean, that would be kind of grody. I have a 2-year-old daughter and a 4-year-old son, Marcus and Naomi, and Marcus has recently become totally independent of pull-ups and diapers. This last summer, actually, he's been sleeping all night without diapers. Naomi, who's 2, just recently started sleeping all night long with no diapers. And if you know the struggle, you know the struggle. Diapers are very expensive, and they're also pretty gross. They're not meant to be a permanent solution. And instead of, if diapers, like a crutch, are a permanent solution, instead of being a helpful thing, they become a harmful thing. You won't really be, it's not easy to have friends if you're walking around with diapers on, right? Can we all agree on that tonight? Yes, we can agree on this. Diapers, not in style. They're never going to come in style. And so my point that I really want to start with tonight is crutches are not meant to be permanent. Crutches will get you by, but they will hold you back in the long run. If you are not reliant on your own strength, on your own 2 feet, crutches will hold you back. But for a season, they can actually help you get healthy. So there's other things like diapers and crutches, but they're invisible crutches. And in society, there's lots of crutches. People use crutches to get through life. You probably understand by now about, like, drug addiction, right? People use drugs to cope with the weight of life. People use drugs to put themselves to sleep so that they can block out all the fear and all the anxiety and all the things that they're weighing them down. People use drugs. Another invisible crutch would be shopping. Any shopping lovers? I'm a shopper. I love shopping if I have money. There's 2 conditions. If I have money, I love shopping. And if I know what I want, I love shopping. If I don't have those 2 things, don't waste my time. Not worth it. Shopping is a way that people cope. It's a crutch to kind of make, if you have a bad day and you just go shopping and you buy yourself a new shirt, you're like, oh man, feeling fresh. Buy yourself a new, I don't know, what do girls buy? Blouses? I don't know. Dresses. Shoes are universal. Okay, another invisible crutch, something that you don't see but that we use in order to get through life is, no, gossiping. Gossiping, right? If we don't feel good about ourselves and we notice so-and-so has that issue, then we talk about them, we don't feel so bad about my issue. And that's another invisible crutch. What? Oh man, I'm gonna step on some toes tonight. What about gaming? Gaming is an invisible crutch. You know why it's an invisible crutch? You might be like, no, don't touch my gaming. I am a very good gamer. And you might be a very good gamer, but the problem with being a very good gamer is sometimes, not all the time, sometimes you might be really, really good in that game and really, really lousy in real life. Man, I'm preaching. Like, I'm not even in the message tonight. You might feel so successful in that game. You might be the best of the best, the top of the tier, the cream of the crop, the creme de la creme. And then in life, you're failing in high school. Whoa. You're yelling at your parents. You're blowing up on your parents. Can't get along with your friends. Can't keep a boyfriend or girlfriend. Ooh. That's actually for the best, but. Oh, man. I'll move. That's an invisible crutch. Eating is an invisible crutch that becomes more and more visible over time. Y'all are like, Alex, shut up. You haven't put on a pound in the last 10 years. God is good, Liz. God is good. I want to make the case that even good things, and I just listed off some good things, right? Gaming is good. Food is good. Shopping is good. Like, what was the other thing? Drugs. Like, hey, pain pills are good. I just had a crown. Well, they're not good in excess, but in moderation, they do serve a purpose in our life. If you're addicted to them, they're not good. You are accurate. Hear me tonight. Even good things can become bad crutches over time if we put our trust in, if we lean on them too much. And that's the point of this tonight's message. So if you're taking notes, you need to write that down. Even good things can become crutches. Even God-given giftings can become crutches. And there's so many of us in the room tonight. You have natural, God-given giftings. You have abilities, passions. You have unique perspective. You have unique language and opportunities. And even those good things that God has given you. You might have a good sense of humor. You might have a creative eye. You might be very intelligent. And you're looking at me like, man, I can't believe I'm listening to this guy. I don't know what your situation is. But even those God-given giftings can become, what are these? That's right. Even. And you're like, what, Alex? Why would God give me something that could hurt me and hold me back? Alex, does God even do that? And I'm so glad you asked me that question, because yes, God does give you things in your life that you get to choose. Will I use this for good, or will I allow this to hurt me? Will this thing help me? Will this thing help others, or will it hurt me and hurt others? And that is reality. So I hope you're, maybe that's just blowing your mind tonight. Like, God gives me things that could hurt me. Like, yes, God gives you things that can hurt you. And if you don't believe me, we're going to go to the Bible and you can take the Bible's word for it, not just my word. So if you have your Bible tonight, open up to the book of Judges. Everybody say Judges. 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 Chapter 13. I'm going to really skim read. I'm going to summarize a bunch of this passage, this story tonight, because we're going to be reading about a dude named Samson. Samson, he was one of the strongest dudes ever recorded in the Bible, and he had superhuman strength. He had strength that was given to him by God. And so as you're turning in your Bibles tonight, Judges chapter 13, and we are actually going to land, and where we're actually going to dive into the text a little bit more in depth is chapter 16. But I want to give you guys some context of this story. But first, man, I just need to pray. I just need to pray. Would you guys pray with me? Come on. Jesus, I thank you for your word. I thank you for this night. I thank you for every person here, no matter where we're at in our journey of faith, in our journey of life. I pray that you would speak to us individually and collectively. You would help us to understand what is holding us back from trusting you more and walking out your God-given purpose that each of us have. We ask for this in Jesus' name. Everybody set. Amen. Come on. Okay, Judges chapter 13, verse 1. The nation of Israel was not following God's leadership. They weren't honoring God. They weren't trusting in God. They weren't following God's instructions. And so God says to Israel, like, okay, you're going to do this on your own. I'll remove my hand of protection. I'll remove my hand of blessing and allow some of this, you know, neighboring, more powerful nations to overpower you and oppress you. And so the Israelite nation, we see this in chapter 13, verse 1. The Israelite nation was oppressed by the Philistines for over 40 years. 40 years is a long time. Anybody here over the age of 40? Don't raise your hand. I'm sorry. There are a couple of us. I'm not over 40 yet. I feel like it tonight. Yet. Yes. So 40 years is a long time. That was my point. 40 years is a long time. A lot of you are probably like in your teenage years, and you feel like your life is, you know, really long, right? Every day, every school year, it's like stretches on and on and on. 40 years of oppression the Israelites were just dealing with the Philistines. And verse 5 says, there's these two people, Zorah and his wife, these two people want to have a kid. And the angel of the Lord comes to them and says, hey, Verse 5. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son, and his hair must never be cut. Kind of like our main man, Joe. Where's my friend, Joe? Joe Ryan, my man. Come on. His hair will never be cut, for he will be dedicated to God as a Nazirite from birth. He will, and this is the key, he will begin to rescue Israel from the Philistines. Okay, so that's the purpose. Verse 24, fast forward with me. We're going to scroll down. This is all the context. When her son was born, she named him Samson. Everybody say Samson. Samson. And the Lord blessed him as he grew up. The Lord blessed him as he grew up. This is so cool. God sees this opportunity to help the Israelite people break free from slavery. They were oppressed. They would take one step forward and then get cut down and pushed back. And they were in this stagnant place where they weren't growing, they weren't succeeding, they weren't experiencing favor. And God is cares for his people, and he's going to use a person just like you, just like me, born so simple, so weak, so just seemingly insignificant, and he's going to use this little baby to help bring Israel out of oppression. Verse 14. Now, this baby was a little spoiled. You ever know a spoiled person? Come on, raise your hand. You know somebody who's spoiled, who gets whatever they want. They literally throw a fit on aisle 7 because they want the candy, and the mom is like, okay, take the candy, right? And then as an adult, they're like, they get what they want. They always get what they want. Yeah, we all know those people. Are they annoying? Yes. This is the case with Samson. He gets everything he wants. And I'm not going to get into 14 and 15, but I'm going to summarize for you guys. Samson, he got whatever he wanted. If he wanted that new thing, he got it. If he wanted that thing, he got it. If he wanted that relationship, he got it. And so he goes to this Philistine village, neighboring village, and he sees this girl. Uh-oh. Bounce, go wow, wow. How you doing? And he comes home to mommy and daddy and says, a young Philistine woman in Timnah caught my eye. How you doing, girl? I want to marry her. Get her for me. This is Samson talking to his mommy and daddy. Mommy, I want her. Get her for me. Like, what a baby. And so their response when he returned home, their response to him, they objected. They're like, isn't there even one woman in our tribe or among all of the Israelites you could marry? Because there was a big difference between these two nations. One nation was godly and followed God's commandment and his law, and the other nation was just like, they were so far from God. And they said, why must you go to a pagan Philistines, to the pagan Philistines to find a wife? But Samson told his father, get her for me. She looks good to me. This is in the Bible, folks. I love this. I love this. It's like the Jersey Shore Bible time edition. Y'all probably like, what is the Jersey Shore? Y'all too young. Not verse 20. Oh, this is good. So his parents are like, okay, they arrange the marriage, the wedding, and there's this big celebration, and Samson, he got himself in a little bit of trouble. He gave this riddle, and he's like, to all his groomsmen, and things were a little different back then. Groomsmen, you know, meant something different than today. It's like, but he's like, hey, if you solve this riddle, like, I'll give you all this money, and he knew that they wouldn't solve it. And so they convinced his new wife to figure out what the answer to the riddle was. And then his new wife, told all the groomsmen, and the groomsmen told Samson, and Samson went off. He went off. He was so livid. He had the biggest tantrum of his life, and he just kicked his feet and he stomped and he obviously, like, he paid the groomsman, but he stole what he got to pay the groomsman, and then he ran away to mommy and daddy's house. I am not making it up, folks. He ran away to his mom and dad's house. Verse 19, chapter 14, verse 19. But Samson was furious about what had happened, and he went back home to live with his father and mother. He's a grown man. He's married. And on his wedding celebration, he gets upset, and he leaves his new wife, runs home to mommy and daddy, because mommy and daddy always give him what he wants. And so then, because he married this Philistine woman, the Philistine woman's father was like, hey, Samson left. You can marry somebody else. So he gives his daughter to be married to the best man of the wedding. I'm not making it up. It's in the Bible. That's low blow. Long story short, he comes back to be reacquainted with his wife and realizes that she has married another dude. Not just another dude, but the best man in his wedding. And he goes nuts. But yet, I want you guys to remember, this lunatic, this emotionally unstable guy, is the one that God said, I'm going to use you to help deliver the Israelite nation from the oppression. Isn't that interesting? So maybe if you have emotional issues here tonight and you like on a roller coaster all the time, who knows? God could use you too. If you know me, I'm an emotional person. So like, hey, that is good. God can use me too. And so we see this pattern start to enter into the Samson of life over these chapters. We see this pattern where Samson sees something, wants it, puts his trust in it, and then is betrayed, right? He was betrayed by his new wife. He was betrayed by his best man. He was betrayed and then blows up. And there's no consequences. He never faces any consequences for his actions because he runs home to mommy and daddy. And you know, he's fine because he's super strong. Like, he's got this long hair and he's strong. But he keeps putting his trust in the wrong things. He keeps putting his trust in other things. And so finally, in chapter 16, where we're going to land tonight. So if you turn to your Bible, chapter 16, verse 4. We're gonna pick up here. It says, sometime later, Samson fell in love with a woman named Delilah. Hey there, Delilah, what's it like in Philistine nation? I don't know the words to the parody, so I won't sing anymore. Who lived in the valley of Sorek. The rulers of the Philistines went to her and said, entice Samson to tell you what makes him so strong. And at this point in, like, I skimmed over this, but Samson has killed over 1,000 Philistines by himself. That's like quite the kill streak, fellas and ladies. Like, he is excellent. Like, he is a killing machine. He is, and the Philistine nation was afraid of him because he was so powerful. So they go to Delilah and they say, hey, entice him, and then each of us will give you 1,100 pieces of silver. So, verse 6, Delilah said to Samson, please tell me what makes you so strong and what it would take to tie you up secretly or securely. And just side note, ladies and gentlemen, if somebody asks what it takes to tie you up, just run, just run, just run. Samson's, verse 7, Samson replied, if I were tied up with 7 new bowstrings, like a bow and arrow, bowstrings, that would not yet have been dried. I would become as weak as anyone else. Verse 8, so the Philistine rulers brought Delilah 7 new bowstrings, and she tied Samson up with them. She had hidden some men in one of the inner rooms of her house, and she cried out, Samson, the Philistines have come to capture you. But Samson snapped the bowstrings as a piece of string snaps when it is burned by the fire. So the secret of his strength was not discovered. So we see this. Samson sleeping with the enemy, thinks he's invincible. He puts his trust in this woman. He's like hanging out with her. He's sleeping with her, and he sleeps. He's not afraid of anything. And then she betrays him. So he trusts her. She betrays him. No consequences. He snaps the bowstrings, fights off this Philistine dudes. All is well. This happens four times. Four times. Like, Samson has to be the dumbest lunk out there, guys. Like, he's just not intelligent. He's just not wise. And I think his stupidity comes from a life that lived where there's no consequences for negative actions. See, consequences, although they are painful, they are very good. They help us grow. They help us. We realize the effects of our actions, how we affect others, how our actions affect us. And Samson has not experienced consequences for his failure, for his lack of caution, for his misplaced trust. And so you see, Samson is using his God-given strength as a crutch. He's leaning on the strength. And we're about to watch the strength collapse out from under him. Verse 17. Finally, Samson shared his secret with her. "My hair has never been cut," he confessed. "For I was dedicated to God as a Nazarite from birth. If my head were shaved, my strength would leave me, and I would become as weak as anyone else." Verse 18, Delilah realized that he had finally told her the truth. So she sent for the Philistine rulers. "Come back one more time," she said, "for he has finally told me his secret." So they come back. She shaved his head. He had dreadlocks. Says he had 7 locks of hair. She shaved him clean. And the Philistine dudes arrested Samson. And then you know what happened? They gouged out his eyes. Means they took like a spoon and gouged out his eyes so he couldn't see. And you go from hero, Samson, the one who slayed over 1,000 Philistines, who's been given the responsibility to judge the nation of Israel, to help the nation of Israel find freedom from the oppression, to zero. The dude who has no strength, no friends, in a foreign country, no sight, and he's put in a grain silo with the task of grinding grain. A job for an animal. And it was a slap in the face. And so Samson learned to trust the crutch, the thing that God gave him to help the nation of Israel, failed him when he used it for his good. There's a message here tonight, and if you've been around church long enough, you probably know where I'm going with this. But the purpose of the strength of Samson, the purpose of your giftings, the purpose of your personality, your opportunities, your unique perspective, the purpose is not so you can be getting by. The purpose of your affluency, your money, your wealth, your reputation is not so that you can just get by in life. It's not so that you can succeed in life. It's not so that you can ascend to, you know, like greater heights. The purpose of the God-given giftings that each and every one of us have is much bigger than ourselves. And it was never meant to be a means of supporting us. God doesn't want us to trust in our nature, in our ability. He wants us to trust in him. He wants us to trust in him. And the Bible says, in our weakness, he is made strong. In our humility, God is exalted. And so, like tonight, I want you to hear me. God-given talent, if you're taking notes, write this down. God-given talent
without God-given purpose will always, 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 always result in a giant mess. Just like Samson, if you trust in your strength over God's strength, if you think that your ability, your influence, your power, your resources is for you, it will result in a giant mess. You might not end up with your eyes gouged out, but man, it will be messy. It will be painful. Hear me tonight. I am pleading with you to hear the word of God. Your God-given strength, abilities, is not for you. It's not. I brought this axe. This is my grandpa's axe. He passed away a few years ago. And he left me a couple things, and this is one of those things. This is might look like a $20 axe to you, something that you wouldn't think twice about, but to me it means a lot because I respect my grandpa. He was a godly man. It's not in my notes. But I brought this axe tonight to illustrate something. I don't really know much about using an axe. But I do know a few things about it. And this is what's called a round. It's round. And if I were to take this axe, which is sharp, it's very sharp. It's got a very sharp edge. It's a good weight. It's a really nice curved handle. And if I were to raise it above my head like that, but if I were to have it facing this way, and I were to take this axe and to hit this log with all of my might, with all of my strength, what would happen? I don't know. I'm not going to experiment. But it would be a mess, wouldn't it? It would not fulfill the purpose that I am intending to fulfill. It would not split this log in half. It would actually probably snap the handle. The blade would go flying and hit Ben in the face. And my arms would be like reverberating, like shaking, because that is not the way the axe was supposed to be swinging. And the same is so true in our lives. Hear me tonight, students. The same is true in our lives. When we take our personality, when we take our abilities, when we take our strength, and when we use it for ourselves, it's just like swinging this axe upside down. Man, I'm preaching tonight. You better wake up with me. God doesn't want you to end up in a mess. He wants you to fulfill the God-given purpose and make some differences. Come on. He wants you to use what God has given you. Man, not for you. Not for you. But for so many more. God has gifted you. Hear me tonight. You are unique. There is not one of you in this room that is the same. That is God's design. That's beautiful. And to think that we would take our uniqueness and turn it into a crutch. Man, what a tragedy. What a tragedy to think, like, I could take my personality and I could make it big. I could be a YouTuber. I could get a following, and I could really bless myself and bless my immediate family, but really miss the God-given purpose, the audience that God has equipped me with, and not use it to help people find and follow Jesus Christ. What a missed opportunity. Man, I don't want us to live our lives and think that it's all about me, and we live in this world where we're told, do whatever makes you happy. You know, follow your heart. You do you, boo-boo. But no, it's so much deeper than that. Romans 8:28. Oh, write this down. Using the talent God gave me for my purpose will only result in a mess. If you have your Bible, turn with me to Romans 8:28. This passage is so powerful. Romans 8:28. Pastor was preaching on it on Sunday, man. If you guys aren't here in church on Sunday, you are missing out. Man, church is so good. God has blessed us with such a great church. Romans 8:28, if I could turn there, says this. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to whose purpose? His purpose. Whose purpose? His purpose. Whose purpose? His purpose. I love this Bible verse, and I think a lot of times we listen to it, we hear it, we read it, we say it. God works all things together for the good of those who are called according to his purpose. And we just think about the first part. You know, God works everything together for my good. But really, he only works things together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Man, what would happen if we would align our lives with the purpose that God gave us? Man, we would see mountains move. We would see hatred diminished in our schools. We would see hope and healing. We would see anxiety be gone in the name of Jesus. Man, I don't know about you, but I want to see that. I want to see God move. I want to see God heal. I want to see God do miracles. And like I read about Jesus in the Bible, and I'm like, man, what would it be like to walk with him? And then he's like, I am walking with you. You're just not walking with me. Man, God wants us to trust in his purpose. Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. That's what God created you to do, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them, not hobble in them. Do you notice how it said walk in them, not hobble in them? God created us to walk independent of crutches, independent of things that we're putting our trust in. God created us to trust in him and him alone. Let's look beyond ourselves and see that God has created us for so much more than just fulfilling our temporary desires. Just like Samson, you know, I relate to Samson. There's a lot of things in my life I'm like, I see that, I want it. I see that car, I want it. I see those shoes, I want it. I see that fill in the blank, I want it. And you are no different. You know why I know that? Because you're human just the same as I'm human. And we have these temporary desires that are so strong. I'm not negating the strength of your desires tonight, but I am saying your temporary desires are just that, temporary. God would say, hey, change your desires. Look beyond the temporary. Look eternally. Align your desires with what I created you for, and watch me work. So what is God's desire? God's desire ultimately is that none should perish. That none should perish. That none should perish. God's purpose for your life and for my life would be that none should perish. And God wants to use you. He wants you to walk out your God-given purpose and to speak truth to people in need, to speak hope over people that are hurting, to give help to those that are helpless. And we get that opportunity every single day. 2 Peter 3:9 says, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you. Say this with me. Not wanting anyone to perish. Say that again. Not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. You and I, we make mistakes. Every single person on the planet, no one's perfect. We all make mistakes. And we are in need of a Savior. We are in need of responding to Jesus Christ, the Lord of our lives, the way, the truth, and the life. And if we will not respond to him and say, I'm sorry, Jesus, I need you. I want to live for you. I want to take my life, the giftings you've given me, and I want to turn 180. I want to go from being selfish to being living on purpose for you. I want to experience God, how you can make everything change. You can move mountains. You can make things happen in my life beyond my own ability. If that's you tonight, you just need to know. This moment, God created you for this moment. God brought you here to this place for this moment. And it's not a moment that I take lightly. I take this responsibility very seriously. I look forward to this time because when I finally said yes to Jesus, guys, hear me tonight. Everything changed. I was done playing church. I was done trying to do it myself. I was done trying to follow my impulses and my desires. I was done. I was tired of it. It was hopeless. It was empty. And I was hurting so many people and myself. When I finally said yes to Jesus and I said, okay, Lord, your will be done. Your kingdom come. Not my will, not my kingdom, but your will. Things changed. And something can happen in your life tonight too. If you just come to yourself and say, look, God, I'm not enough. No matter how strong I am, no matter how gifted I am, no matter how affluent I am, no matter what the situation, I'm not enough. God can begin to restore, redeem, and refocus your life. The only one who can lift the weight that you might be carrying tonight is Jesus. And that's the beauty of Jesus, is we get to come here tonight together carrying different weights. Some of you tonight are fighting anxiety. Some of you tonight are fighting a real question of, am I worth it? Am I worth anything? You're fighting that depression. Some of you tonight are fighting an addiction that is literally ruining and messing up your mind. And you know it. You sense it. You sense, I am having issues. And we get to take whatever that weight is, and we just get to put it at the feet of Jesus. And the Bible says, lay down our burdens. Take up his yoke, for it's light. His purpose, his direction, and it's light, and it's full of purpose. It's not easy. Don't hear me wrong. It's hard, but it's way better and carrying the weight of this world. So with every head bowed, every eye closed tonight, as we respond in this just moment between us and God and his word that's so clear tonight, I just want to give you an opportunity to say, you know what, Jesus? First, I want to give you an opportunity to say, you know what, Jesus, I need you. I want to put my trust in you. I want to put my faith in you. I want to turn 180. I want to turn the axe head and start to follow your purpose. If that's you, on the count of three, just raise your hand. I see that hand back there. Anyone else? I see that hand. All those hands. I see those hands. That hand. I see that. I see that hand. Come on. I see that hand. Anyone else? I see that hand. Come on. Awesome. You can put your hands down. I see that hand. Lord, would you repeat after me? Jesus, forgive me. Come into my life. Help me turn 180 degrees to trust in your purpose. In Jesus' name, amen. Still with every head bowed, every eye closed. There's so many of us. I know it. I sense it tonight. There's so many of us here. We have a heavy weight that we're carrying. It might come and go, but it comes more than it goes. And you're carrying that weight here tonight. I want to tell you tonight, you don't have to carry it home with you. You get to leave that weight here at the foot of Jesus. So whatever it is, you know, I just encourage you tonight, in your own heart, in your own mind, take that weight, that heaviness, that burden, and put it down tonight. Trust Jesus with it. Don't trust in your own strength like Samson. Trust Jesus. So Jesus, tonight, I pray for all of those students here tonight that are, all of us here tonight, that are carrying burdens, carrying weight, carrying the shame of our sin, the mistakes that we've made. carrying the anxiety, the fear that overwhelms us and keeps us awake at night. Lord, we're carrying abandonment, fear of being left out. Lord, we're carrying so much shame, so many addictions. I pray for all of us tonight that are just carrying those burdens. I pray, Jesus, you would just help us to put them down at your feet tonight and to pick up your yoke, your purpose, and to walk in the freedom that you paid for on the cross. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for that freedom. I thank you. Come on, in your own heart and mind right now, just say thank you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you for your freedom. We thank you for your deliverance. We thank you for your purpose and your direction in our life. We thank you for lifting our burdens. We love you, Jesus. Now, Jesus, I pray that all of us tonight, as we go our separate ways, Lord, you would keep us safe. Lord, you would remind us, Lord, your purpose is why we were created. And our God-given talent and character and uniqueness without your purpose only results in a mess. God, we ask for you to just help us be aware of what you created for us for. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.